Good morning. Today we are going to review the topics of work, energy, power, and Hooke's law, which are covered on the AP Physics 1 exam.
Hey guys.
Hey Bob.
Hi Bob.
Flippin' physics.
From the equation sheet. In terms of an object or a group of objects, which we call the system, the change in energy of the system equals the work done on the system, which is equal to the force doing that work times the displacement of the object times the cosine of theta, where theta is the angle between the direction of the force and the direction of the displacement of the object. In other words, work causes a change in energy of a system. We'll talk more about that energy in just a bit. Let's concentrate now on the work equation. Mr. P?
Yes, Bobby?
What is the force parallel times displacement?
Oh, right. The force parallel to the displacement equals the force times the cosine of theta.
Remember to always identify which force you're using in your work equation. And it could be the net force, in which case you could substitute in mass times acceleration using Newton's second law. And remember to only use the magnitude for the force and the displacement. It is the cosine of the angle theta which determines whether the work is positive or negative. Bo, what are the dimensions for work?
Work is in joules.
And what is a joule?
A joule is a newton times a meter.
Yeah, a joule is a newton meter.
Bobby, please tell me everything you know about one of our three types of mechanical energy.
Kinetic energy is the energy of motion. The equation is kinetic energy equals 1/2 times the mass of the object times the velocity of the object squared. And kinetic energy will never be negative because mass can't be negative and the velocity is squared.
I prefer to use Ke instead of K for kinetic energy because K can stand for the spring constant, Boltzmann's constant, the dielectric constant, Kelvin's, or even 1,000. So I prefer Ke for kinetic energy. Billy, could you please tell me everything you know about another type of mechanical energy?
Elastic potential energy is the energy stored in a spring or an elastic or stretchy material like a rubber band. Elastic potential energy equals 1/2 times the spring constant times the displacement from the equilibrium position or the rest position squared. The spring constant is a measurement of how much force it takes to compress or expand a spring. And the equilibrium or rest position is where the spring will be in equilibrium without other forces acting on it. And just like kinetic energy, elastic potential energy will never be negative because the spring constant can't be negative and the displacement from equilibrium position is squared.
Very nice. Again, I prefer PE sub E for elastic potential energy, but U sub S can work too. Bo, the last type of mechanical energy, please.
Gravitational potential energy is the energy associated with a gravitational field like the one we live in. It equals the mass of the object times the acceleration due to gravity times the vertical height above the horizontal zero line. You have to identify a horizontal zero line before you begin a problem. Gravitational potential energy can be negative if the object is below the horizontal zero line, which would make the vertical height above the zero line negative. Oh, and we should remember that work and energy are scalars.
Right. Again, I prefer PE sub G for gravitational potential energy. And also, I usually refer to it in terms of absolute gravitational potential energy rather than a change in gravitational potential energy. This equation is for the gravitational potential energy in a constant gravitational field. We'll get to the gravitational potential energy in a non-constant gravitational field in just a little bit. Bobby, what are the dimensions for energy?
Well, we know work and energy have the same units, so joules.
Really, Bobby? Can you prove that? Please start with the equation for kinetic energy and prove to me that it is in joules.
Kinetic energy equals 1/2 mass times velocity squared, so its dimensions are mass in kilograms, and velocity is in meters per second, and velocity is squared, so it's kilograms times meters squared over seconds squared.
And that works out to be joules?
Yes, because that equals kilograms times meters over seconds squared times meters. So you can substitute in newtons for kilograms times meters divided by seconds squared, and you get newtons times meters, which is joules.
Very nice. Carl
conservation of mechanical energy. The total mechanical energy initial equals the total mechanical energy final. Billy, when and how can we use conservation of mechanical energy?
Mechanical energy is conserved in the absence of non-conservative forces. In other words, when there is no friction.
You mean no energy converted to heat, light, or sound via the sliding friction between two surfaces, right?
Right. And before we use the conservation of mechanical energy equation, we need to specifically identify the initial and final points. We also need to identify the horizontal zero line. Then we identify which types of mechanical energy are present at the initial and final points, substitute in those equations, and solve the problem.
Remember as well that you can't have energy added to the system via a force applied and still use conservation of mechanical energy. Now, what if you need to use energy, however, energy is being converted to heat, light, or sound via friction? What do you do then?
Then we go back to the work equation. The work due to friction equals the change in mechanical energy of the system. For the work due to friction, substitute in the force of friction times the displacement times the cosine of the angle between the force of friction and the displacement, which should be 180 degrees because the force of friction opposes motion. And that equals the mechanical energy final minus the mechanical energy initial. We need to identify the initial and final points and the horizontal zero line. That assumes that there is no energy added or removed from the system via a force applied. If there is, then we also need to include the work done by the force applied with the work done by the force of friction.
Very nice. Now let's talk about the rate at which work is done, which is called power. Power is simply how long it takes to change the energy of the system, or how long it takes to do work on the system. And we can also substitute in the equation for work. And because d over delta t, or the displacement over change in time, is velocity, we now have an equation for power in terms of velocity. And remember, just like the work equation, you need to identify which force is doing the work, and theta is the angle between the direction of the force and the direction of the velocity of the object. Bobby, what are the dimensions for power?
Power is in joules per second, which are called watts.
Also, 746 watts is equivalent to 1 horsepower. You certainly don't need to memorize that. However, it's good to be familiar with the term. Now let's talk about Hooke's law. Hooke's law. The force of a spring is linearly proportional to the displacement from equilibrium position. In other words, the force of the spring is equal to the spring constant multiplied by that displacement from equilibrium, or what is also called rest position. And if you make a graph of the force of a spring versus the displacement from equilibrium position, the slope of the best fit line will be the spring constant of the spring, which brings us to typical dimensions for the spring constant. The spring constant is in force per unit length, therefore newtons per meter. This brings us to the end of my review lesson on work energy and power for AP Physics 1. My next review lesson is about linear momentum and impulse. You are welcome to enjoy that video. You can also go to my website, flippingphysics.com, where you can find all of my AP Physics 1 review videos organized with lecture notes. Thank you very much for learning with me today. I enjoyed learning with you.